woodpeckers of the Lake Tahoe Basin and how they contribute to a healthy forest. For many people, woodpeckers conjure up imagery ranging from the annoying, those pesky birds that perforate the sides of homes new and old, to the absurd, woody woodpecker up to his usual hijinks, to the industrious. Woodpeckers are considered by many as the lumberjacks of the bird world, after all. There's no question that they can be all of those things. During the spring of 2020, for example, a white-headed woodpecker turned one of the walls of my neighbor's second home into Swiss cheese. I've watched a pileated woodpecker rear back its head while belting out a maniacal laugh before flying off, as if it were a physical incarnation of the cartoon character. And countless species have claimed the vacant tree cavities created by all types of woodpeckers as their home. Based on the aforementioned examples, it might seem like woodpeckers are easy to label or characterize. However, their natural tendencies and actions are quite profound and contribute to the overall health of forests. Hey folks, my name is Jared Manninen. I've lived at Lake Tahoe since 2005 and have always been fascinated with the variety of woodpeckers that also call Lake Tahoe home. Incredibly, 12 species of woodpeckers have been officially sighted in the Lake Tahoe Basin, this according to the Tahoe Institute of Natural Science. This isn't to say that all 12 species are common or frequently found. In fact, probably only half of those woodpeckers are non-migratory or full-time residents. This means that the other half appear infrequently through occasional visits to the basin. But those limited viewing opportunities yield very memorable sightings. On any given day of birding or hiking through the mountains and forests of Lake Tahoe, you can witness multiple woodpecker species. I find this quite remarkable considering the relatively small and finite size of the Lake Tahoe Basin. Although Lake Tahoe hosts a diverse population of woodpeckers, there's no definitive reason why such a high concentration of them exists here. Their presence doesn't necessarily indicate any specific climate event or occurrence. They don't portend an ominous calamity or signal cause for jubilant celebration, other than the fact that they're very cool to watch. Some logical reasons, however, for their presence at Lake Tahoe include: Lake Tahoe features a mix of old and new forest habitats that can accommodate many varieties of woodpeckers. Lake Tahoe includes many conifer trees, so there are plenty of softer wood trees that age and rot relatively quickly, yielding insect species preferred by woodpeckers. Lake Tahoe is home to many aspen trees, and locally, there isn't a woodpecker that doesn't love aspens. Lake Tahoe is host to a variety of microclimates, again, providing diverse habitats for different woodpecker species. And lastly, Lake Tahoe is also filled with and surrounded by numerous acres worth of prime real estate, i.e. open space and wildland, void of human activity, which is good for woodpeckers because they're generally considered to be shy birds. Regardless of the reason for their concentrated presence at Lake Tahoe, woodpeckers are unique birds that contribute in many ways to maintaining a healthy forest. The three primary ways in which woodpeckers help to maintain healthy forests are: they provide nesting cavities for many species of wildlife, they're a check on the insect population, and they help to accelerate the decomposition of dead and dying trees. Woodpeckers provide nesting cavities for many species of wildlife. Woodpeckers are primary cavity nesters, meaning that they excavate from scratch new homes in which to live. This is a critical service to the local fauna population. Many species of birds and other wildlife, such as squirrels and chipmunks, are considered secondary nesters because they take up residence in the cavities left by woodpeckers. In fact, according to an article about woodpeckers published in the summer 2017 edition of the Western Arborist, about 40 of the 60 other cavity nesting birds in North America nest in the abandoned homes of woodpeckers. Keep in mind that woodpeckers aren't just building homes for other critters out of the goodness of their hearts. Most cavities left behind are simply the result of woodpeckers foraging for their next meal. Thanks to the variety of woodpeckers at Lake Tahoe, there's an abundance of various sized tree cavities in which to support a variety of other species. One element that I find interesting about woodpeckers building homes for themselves is that they don't only chisel their nests from the outside. Once they've burrowed far enough into a tree, they continue their operation from inside. Point in case is that white-headed woodpecker that built itself a home inside my neighbor's wall. I've heard it spend hours pecking away from the inside of the house's wall. I've also heard a hairy woodpecker drilling from the inside of an old branchless, yet still upright, snag. In both cases, I spent quite a long time trying to pinpoint the location of the woodpecker. The challenge came from the sound being so muffled and indirect. Woodpeckers are a check on the insect population. Much of a bird's day involves searching for food. Woodpeckers are no different in this respect, and it's estimated that woodpeckers can consume thousands of insects a day. Also, the way in which woodpeckers seek food yields benefits to other species. Some woodpeckers prefer to work on live trees, while others gravitate toward dead ones due to the high concentration of insects that reside within them. Regardless, when woodpeckers hammer away at a tree, it's usually because they're searching for food such as larvae and wood-boring insects. For example, you may find a pileated woodpecker chiseling away at a rotten log on the forest floor in search of carpenter ants, which is one of their favorite foods. As I previously mentioned, the cavities left behind by woodpeckers provide homes for other wildlife, and many of the species who inhabit those cavities also happen to be insectivores. Additionally, the exposed sections of the trees a woodpecker excavates provide access for other insectivores to probe for food. In the case of red-breasted sapsuckers, they'll systematically peck at live trees in order to cause them to yield sap. They'll leave the site while the sap begins to collect, and during that time, other wildlife will begin to consume the fresh sap, along with any insects that become trapped in it. When the sapsuckers return, they'll continue to feed on the flowing sap and all of the resultant trapped insects. Without woodpeckers and other insectivores, the world would most likely be overrun by the insect population. Woodpeckers help to accelerate the decomposition of dead and dying trees. If half a tree's worth with regard to forest health comes with its death, for example, all of the nutrients it gives back to the earth, then we can thank woodpeckers for accelerating its rate of decomposition. The insects for which a woodpecker searches definitely contribute to the breakdown of trees, but it's at a very slow rate. However, the violent mechanical action of a woodpecker chipping, chiseling, and hammering away at a tree sends fragments flying in all directions. This helps to disperse the nutrients in which that dying tree provides across the forest floor. The following is a list of unique aspects about woodpeckers that I find interesting and fascinating to study. Woodpeckers use drumming as a means of communication instead of traditional birdsong. The rapid-fire drumming is probably the sound most associated with woodpeckers, and it's a method by which woodpeckers establish their territory and attract a mate. Drumming is not actually considered damaging to a tree, as it's accomplished using less force, probably more akin to a boxer's jab than a big right cross. In the video clip featured in this project of the white-headed woodpecker, to me it sounds like the male, and you can tell this by the flash of red on its head, is having a conversation with another woodpecker in the distance. I happen to know that there's a mating couple of white-headed woodpeckers in the same location in which I recorded this woodpecker drumming, so I believe the two of them are simply having a conversation while they're getting ready for the day. Woodpeckers' brains aren't adversely affected by their work for multiple reasons. In recent years, woodpeckers have been a point of interest for scientists who study the effects of brain trauma, particularly with regard to impacts to the head. Research has discovered that the orientation of a woodpecker's brain is perpendicular to the force of impact, which minimizes the effects of brain movement. A woodpecker's skull contains less fluid, and their brain occupies more space in the skull, decreasing the amount of sloshing around their brain may experience. Woodpeckers push their lower beak slightly forward of the upper half, right before the point of impact, so that their body, of which the lower beak is connected, absorbs most of the impact. Their beak features a harder outer surface and a softer inner core to minimize impact and vibration, which reminds me of a bicycle helmet design. While pecking, a woodpecker retracts its exceptionally long tongue and wraps it around its skull, which acts as a vibration-dampening system for their brains. Woodpeckers have exceptionally strong toes in which to cling to the sides of trees, but only in an upright position. Woodpeckers don't have the correct anatomy to climb down trees face forward like nuthatches, for example. Instead, they hop and walk backwards down trees. The tail feathers of a woodpecker are stiff so that they can use them as a prop or kickstand as they cling to the side of a tree. In combination with those strong toes, woodpeckers are able to position their bodies away from the trees as they excavate. Keeping their bodies off of the tree provides leverage, for example, a good position from which to work, and prevents them from experiencing the vibrations through the tree that they're creating. Generally, woodpeckers prefer an open forest that lacks a robust understory so that they can work while maintaining a watchful eye for predators. In conclusion, I just wanted to point out that as much as I wanted to produce an in-depth video about all 12 types of woodpeckers that have been sighted at Lake Tahoe, that would have obviously been an ambitious project, probably one worthy of, at the very least, a feature-length movie. Since I currently don't have the time nor the resources to accomplish such a feat, I instead elected to create a brief overview of the Lake Tahoe woodpeckers in order to provide you with a starting point and hopefully some inspiration for your own further research. There are still those four more uncommon species of woodpeckers at Lake Tahoe that I've yet to photograph, so my work is not finished, and therefore I'll always keep my eyes and ears open for the telltale signs of woodpeckers, hoping to catch a glimpse of those elusive birds. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out. You can find me at tahoetrailguide.com or jaredmanninen.com. Thank you for watching.